All right, everybody, welcome to Grow Old Man Record Night.
Welcome.
Welcome, welcome.
This is your one-stop shop for big-time business on Friday night. We're trying to get back to our regularly scheduled type entertainment that we normally do here.
Yeah. Hey, somebody chat in how the audio mix is. Just wondering.
Yeah, let us know. We got some music playing underneath us. If it ain't worth a shit, let us know about it. I don't know.
No, we don't care about that. We just want to make sure the levels are okay.
Yeah, that you're not drowning us out.
I don't care if they like it or not.
Yeah, I don't care if you like it. Not your fucking show. Get your own show.
It's actually a German group that is playing a bunch of Brazilian music, I believe. Yeah, something I picked up.
I asked four lawyers. One of them is even a German, and they all said the same thing.
What?
Name that movie. Leave it in the comments. That's your test for tonight. I asked four lawyers. One of them is even a German, and they all said the same thing. You know what it is?
Boys from Brazil.
It's an 80s movie. I'll tell you that. It's almost up. Leave it in the comments. We'll see if anybody's worth a shit out there. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate you. This is where we come to blow off steam. We come to anchor steam. We come to blow off steam on a Friday night. And I had a week off. I didn't have to work this week. So it's been several days of like one big damn record show.
Speaking of blowing off steam.
My liver hurts so bad.
Somebody fucking turned my world upside down this week.
What happened?
They drove off with one of our cars right out of our driveway.
You didn't tell them they could?
I didn't give them permission to.
So somebody run off with one of your cars?
Yeah, they did.
That's against the law.
That's against the law, and it really just made my week kind of bullshit.
What's the what's the game plan from here? What do you do?
You go forward. Move ahead.
Go forward.
Try to detect it. It's not too late.
You got any leads?
We got no leads right now.
Yeah, we got a team working around the clock.
Yes,
they're working in shifts.
Yeah, they're working on it real hard. Basically, everybody says, yeah, what'll happen is they'll run out of gas and they'll just leave us somewhere.
Still, that sucks, though.
And then those in the know, I know this guy who knows a little bit about crime because he was a criminal at one point. And
we're not saying whether or whether or not they're a guest on the show.
But he says that they basically, if they want to, if they're the type, they would go to an apartment complex, find another Camry, swap tags with it, and then run a drug run into Charlotte and back or something like stupid like that.
That could be something.
If the cops run the tag, it's just a Camry that shows up, not a stolen car.
Yeah, it's true. I also know some people that used to cruise apartment complexes for similar vehicles that they had, and they would steal parts off of them. They may or may not be a guest that appears on the show. A different person than what we just mentioned.
Wow. Okay. Great show.
Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next week.
I'm glad to be here. I don't think I've been here in like two or three
weeks.
It's
been a long time, man. It's been a real weird
few weeks.
There was a work week, and then I had a show week, and then
did a show with Boss Man.
Boss Man was here last week. We had a big old time. Him and Kimmy stopped by.
I don't think he's in the house today.
No, he's not in the house.
Somebody,
we had
somebody might be here.
We got a guest, a secret guest, coming up shortly on the show. So I know Brohammer's already guessed it, so don't give it away real early on. But if you think about who may be our secret mystery guest for the evening, let's see. We'll give you a clue. God, I'm not smart enough or sober enough to give you an accurate clue that wouldn't just totally give it away.
I'll just move on.
Just move on. Damn it, there was another record I was supposed to play. That's all right.
Really?
I'll tell somebody to get off the shelf and we can at least talk about it and dig of the week or something. So what's been going on? You been doing a lot of digging?
Not really.
Neither.
I went to like a choral festival in Durham.
Choral festival?
A choral festival.
Uh-huh.
Where people get together to sing. It was a bunch of choirs.
Oh, I see.
Got together to make a mass choir, basically.
Oh, I see. And, you said the blind man who.
Of course, I went to another town and wanted to find
them.
There's a nice price books. Which,
oh, yeah.
There was one in Greensboro, but there's one in Raleigh. I've hit that before. Yep. I hit the one in Durham.
Durham.
But I had like 10 minutes, so it was one of those get in there and get out kind of things. And I was able to find some cool stuff.
Those are good stores. Unlike the School Kids Records in Raleigh, which I've mentioned before.
I've shopped there before, but you like in the 80s, probably.
I want to take the owner, open his asshole with a speculum and vomit into it. That's what I think about his prices. Asshole full of vomit via speculum.
That is where I got that
Mikey Bananas,
that
2015.
That Pink Floyd.
Yeah, back in the 80s. Bootleg. It was great. And me and Cameraman were there. It was there in the 90s. Also, when it was still on Hillsborough
Street.
Also
great.
It was still a great store.
It's no longer in the same location.
They're totally taking advantage of the whole hipster vinyl thing and just shoving it right up.
The keister hole.
The old keister hole.
Okay.
The old meat wagon. Whatever, you know? Two Weeches Own.
I saw a great documentary recently. I think it was on Netflix, maybe? It was on some network. About The Jam? Are you familiar with the band called The Jam? A British band?
Yeah, but I don't know
enough
about them.
They didn't hit big here, but they were big in England. They were the big band.
How'd you stumble across it?
I don't remember. I was looking at another documentary, and this one came up, and the folks that were interviewing, like, was the guy... played in The Hobbit. He played Frodo or Bilbo. Played Bilbo.
Sean Austin?
No.
Rudy?
No. He was also in The Office. He was the lead character in The Office.
In the British Office.
The British Office.
I don't know his name.
Yeah, Martin Scorsese.
Yes.
Martin Short. Martin.
Was he also in Fargo, the show on FX?
I don't know.
Been watching that. Crazy show.
I quit.
Crazy.
But yeah, it was really good, and it makes me want to go find their records.
Metal Theologians says they're really good, The Jam.
They are very good. I have a big respect for them just watching that video. So.
Actually,
he shows up, the lead guy shows up on one of my albums I dug.
I've got an album.
It's a Karma thing.
That reminded me. I watched a documentary today, and it's kind of reason why I played the album. We have a tie-in. See what happens, folks?
You're not even wearing a tie.
I don't have a tie. I got a bandana.
So I will say that we were watching a little bit of a video.
Yeah, what is that all about now?
Well, I brought this, I didn't really forget about, but my next door neighbor comes by last weekend and said, hey, I wanted to return this.
Joe
and
Susan.
Realized I still had this. And it was a tape that I let him borrow, I think when I first met him, basically.
Maybe
10 years ago. And it was a tape from a school in Savannah called Savannah College of Art and Design.
SCAD.
Very good school.
You know where Jack teaches?
Expensive. It's where Jack teaches. He doesn't piss on the chairs there, but that's where he teaches. But it was called White Rod, A Hero for the 21st Century. Don't give it away. But it was very interesting. I'll move it in. Because I was actually a part of this. The guy who directed this, his name...
Yeah, look down there now.
The guy's named Damon Smith.
Who's that guy?
It's Vance Van Pufflin. He hosts an exclusive behind-the-scenes look at the hit TV show.
Now look at that guy.
Yeah, so he returned this tape I forgot he had. But he went to that school. That's why I let him borrow it, I think. He studied video there. They had a good video department. But I was part of this. He had all this stuff. It was his senior project. Everybody had a senior project. His was White Rod. But he had all this extra. He shot so much stuff. He shot with three guys over the years and had just compiled all this stuff. It didn't make any sense, but it made sense to put it together as a mockumentary. So
that's awesome.
It was kind of fun.
I've watched clips of this online for probably 10 years now.
Yeah, it finally got the OG.
It
used to
like
be under archive.org, and he pulled it off. Damon pulled it off.
Yeah, every time I went to go look at a clip, it would be like, this file has been removed or whatever.
So what I'm going to try and do is get that transferred so we can maybe put some clips.
Totally. Or even
I'd like to show a clip.
If nothing else, for your sake, and I should do this with some of my student films, it's like... just to preserve them.
But
If you keep plugging VHS around.
I brought over a VHS player, and I think we should leave it here so you can play some VHS.
Oh, I've got some. Oh, the van?
I don't need it, and if I need to get it, I'll come get it.
I've got the Star Wars trilogy before they altered it.
You got Super Van?
No, the van.
The van.
It's so awesome. What's Jay doing?
What was that? Jay, don't swallow the video. Don't swallow the Nintendo games. You all right?
Jay's got a game going, but apparently he's choking in the meantime. Whatever that means.
Don't choke on level 5.
He's choking on level 5. I think Jay always chokes on level 5. Anybody? these Super Mario Brothers jokes do anything for anybody?
Hey,
where
you know,
are you at?
You know, I happen, I don't know.
6'2"? You know, oh, that's new
okay,
for Jay.
Okay, whatever, breaking news.
6'2".
But this week, Sam Cully, the guy from the Skull Snaps.
Skull Snaps, yeah.
He, I just happened to friend him on Facebook.
Yeah,
so
he
I
released a statement.
He's just a normal guy, lives in Ohio.
I don't know about normal guy.
Well, Skull Snaps, you guys are familiar with Skull Snaps.
Oh, yeah.
They kind of were ripped off by a lot of hip-hop artists with It's a New Day.
Been sampled more than
the drum track. The drummer's already died. But he put out a kind of a weird statement saying, you know, warning now to all you folks who have made a lot of money off of me at the time, your time is up, we're coming after you, kind of a thing.
Yeah.
He was pretty serious about it. A couple of days he made statements that were very direct about that. And I think all of his posts are in all caps.
I love the Skull Snaps, and I like those guys, and I think they have a total point, but he's not the first one to come out and
no,
say,
but they deserve to be
totally
treated right for what they went through.
But, however, at the time, and not that you could foresee that was going to be the deal, but those types of bands, a lot of those funk bands, along with rock and roll bands, notorious for being very shittily handled by their managers.
Sure, and when they recorded, the company they were working with basically went out of business. So
a lot of
that
people
were
not smart enough to ink deals that protected them and made sure that,
made
they
sense.
Were just like, bro, we're going to play music and get paid for it, what? And then, you know, like Creedence with the deal with Fantasy, and then you realize
right.
like a couple years later, like, oh, wait, we have number one songs, and I'm fucking starving to death.
Like,
none of this should work like this.
Like Hank 3 with Herb Rex.
Carl.
Damn it!
there's a lot of bands like that. So while I sympathize with them, I also say it's your people that probably screwed you to a point. Because there should have been some level of protection previous to it getting to this. I don't know. Maybe not. That was such uncharted territory, though, with hip-hop coming in and, like, we're going to take this really dope drum beat from this obscure funk artist from the 70s that they're all working at car washes now because they failed, but they got this really one dope drum part.
Right.
And we're going to take that and we're going to put it in a song that's going to make 50 million bucks. And now all of a sudden the guys that are starving to death, if nothing else, are pissed off because they're starving to
death.
Well,
they're not starving to death.
You're going to give me mine.
They actually died of like psoriasis of the liver or whatever. So.
So I'm kind of conflicted on that because I...
George is no longer with us, so it was his drum beat.
Yeah. So I think there should be something there, but, you know, I don't know. That's a very gray area.
Sorry about your Cubs, by the way.
Terrible.
I pulled the hard for those sumbitches.
You know, I had the week off.
What was? Who the fuck is that Schwarber fellow?
He's a beast.
He's a beast that doesn't know how to fucking catch a ball is one thing.
No, but he's, I mean, dude, he hit like 5 straight home runs, and I mean, I'm not mad at him.
I blame 2 games on him.
The pitching, so. Just completely.
Yeah, well.
It was not what it was. Postseason's all about the pitching, man. And I knew we were in trouble when homeboy Beardo McGee was he got railed in the
Beardo.
Second game.
Beardo.
That was the gimme game.
Yeah.
Arrieta?
Yeah.
I figured I was telling Jay earlier, if we won the first game and then Arrieta pitching the second game, that's a gimme. Then we'll go to Chicago 2-0, and you can close it out in Chicago. Sweep them right there.
Right.
But when we lost the first game, it's like, okay. And then Arrieta got railed the second game, and I'm like, we're done.
You're done.
I knew we were done after the second game.
Ain't no
game.
Coming back.
Nope. First game didn't bother me so bad.
And
second game, I knew that.
And
was
it's good. A young team that didn't know how to react, you know. It's a young team that didn't know. Everybody felt like next year is their year to really hit it. I don't know what that means.
I don't care about any of that.
I don't know what that means.
The Cubs getting to the playoffs was great. Cubs getting there and swip swap them. Cubs getting there and not making it.
Yeah.
I don't care. They had to go all the way, or I really don't care.
Yeah.
It's that. It's
well,
got
what? Me. What the hell did we play tonight?
Oh, you want to talk about what we played?
I think we should talk about.
Let's
is there anything else
it.
You want to talk about before we talk about what we played tonight?
I don't know. But I tell you what, we played. Actually, I started out tonight with a record you actually gave me, Steve.
Oh yeah, did I give you this? Looks good. It's in good. It's pretty good shape, isn't it?
Yeah, you told me you got it. You had it was double
duplicates.
For you.
I got another set of duplicates on these fellas.
Really?
Yeah, I don't know if it's in this one or not.
Yeah, over here on the turntable, we're listening to some of our buddy Sean0612. Some of his hip-hop instrumentality records.
0612.
Man, he's been with us since day one, man, I tell you.
Was it day one or maybe day two?
Pretty damn close.
And Jay just said he made it to 7-1. Y'all give him a hand. Everybody,
you got it to 7-1?
7-1.
You got one more left?
One life left on
7-1. One life left on Super Mario Brothers, and he's on 7-1.
What do you got?
Eight.
Eight. You're not there yet, son.
Come on now.
Grasshopper.
You got it, Jay. You got it.
I'm pretty nervous this one.
No, come on now.
What we played. What we played. The producer is giving us the roll right. Symbol.
All right. This is The Police. Police. What's that say?
Zenyatta Mandata.
Nope.
No?
It says something else. No, I didn't have this one. I may not have any Police. I know Cameraman has Synchronicity. I may have Synchronicity. That's it, though. So I didn't have this one. But we'll just hold it up quick. I busted this out just for a thrill. Les McCann and Eddie Harris, Swiss Movements. Staple on Grown Man Record Night.
Oh, yeah, that's an early jam.
69 right Atlantic.
That was when we first found the guy talking and singing through a saxophone.
That's the, Eddie Harris.
With a little delay.
That's on that Kmart record. Live at Newport record. Yeah, we played that a couple weeks ago. We played Side 2 of Swiss Movement, which is You Got It in Your Soulness and The Generation Gap. I never played Side 2 of this. I always play the side that's got Duck
Dynasty.
Duck Soup Time. Cold Duck Time. What's wrong with me?
Swiss Movement. This is the first Swiss Movement, right?
That's the first Swiss Movement.
I got the vote.
Terrific.
You got both
playing Montreux, then they got together and recorded together, never really played together. That's the story. Speaking of documentaries on the internet, I watched one this afternoon, which made me want to play this record. Grateful Dead, Working Man's Dead. First Dead record I ever owned, and the first one that really made me stop and think, God damn, I liked Grateful Dead.
You watched that Long Strange Trip movie?
No, this is the
called?
Other one
well, no,
about
called?
Bob Weir.
I thought that's what it was called.
No, it's called The Other One. So it's about Bob Weir and a pretty interesting documentary. And one thing I'll take away, our friend Roger Coleman actually posted on the VC Facebook page earlier some McCoy Tyner stuff.
Yeah.
And that reminded me because in this documentary, Bob Weir said, it's weird being a rhythm guitarist. And all this is really hitting home because I've been a rhythm guitarist for a very long time. And he's like, it's very weird because you know, I've got this other guy that's playing this stuff and I want to compliment it, but I don't want it to be so like, and then you just kind of lose it. So it's not playing something just so mundane that it's stupid. So he's like, I really drew a lot of inspiration from McCoy Tyner on the piano, playing with John Coltrane, which is very similar. If you got Jerry Garcia playing guitar, think about the rhythms you're going to play under that. I mean, what do you do there?
Yeah.
So he kind of took from the voicings that he played with some of the chords on, like McCoy Tyner did. And it's if you go back and listen to it, you can totally see that. He's kind of augmenting the way that he voices the chords to give Jerry space to do what he needs to do.
Right.
But not be
pretty,
so like
pretty damn clever.
1-4-5, 1-4-5 about it that it was so stupid that it's really clever, and I never really thought about that before. And I've not been the greatest Grateful Dead fan before this. I mean, really, I've listened to records. I like the stuff, but that's really cool. The fact that he kind of incorporated this weird way of letting like you know, I always thought about, like, what if you were Les Claypool's guitar player? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You got this badass bass player just killing it.
What do you do?
Yeah. You know, but you do it tastefully in a way that lets this guy do his thing. And it takes a special kind of guitar player to be like, you're the man. I'm just over here fucking filling in. You know, I'm filling the gaps. I'm letting you do your thing. Most guitar players don't want to do anything like that.
No.
My dick's bigger than yours. That's what would happen with most guitar players.
That's true.
I can do that too. I got it.
It's true. It's all
pre- cool, bro. All, I got it.
It's all prima donna.
Total. Lee, adverb. Use that adverb, Mike. Come on, man. Can we do that again?
Yeah.
Can we do it again where I use the adverb? Oh, no. Oh, no. Agent, baby. Next thing I played, Jimmy Smith and Wes Montgomery, The Further Adventures of Jimmy and Wes. Dig of the week from last week. I picked up at the flea market. And I've got the first one that's got him eating the sandwich or the hot dog or whatever.
Sandwich.
This one's pretty good. A little low key at times, very low. I'm hoping on the other side of this, it does a lot more smoking.
Because Jimmy Smith's known for smoking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's some times.
And oh Lord.
Wes Montgomery, not so much.
I mean, he'll bring you.
Yeah.
Cool.
Cup of coffee Sunday morning.
Smooth.
Yeah. And
the octaves.
Yeah. One of the first. Oh, then we had to bust a couple of these out.
We did, in memory of Corey Wells, one of the three lead singers for Three Dog Night.
Passed away just
and
a couple
I
of days ago.
I tried to find cuts that were his, and I think we did. On this Harmony album, I think 71, if I'm not mistaken, Dunhill Records, he definitely sang... what?
Nothing.
He's dropping.
I'm sweating.
What did we listen to? I wanted to listen to Family of Man. And he actually, all three of them sing on that song. It was like, first verse was one of them, second verse another, and then it was Danny Hutton.
Danny Carey.
Then there's the dude whose dick exploded with the mustache.
Freddie Mercury? That's what happens when you have Chuck, AIDS, right?
No, Chuck Negron.
Chuck Knoblauch.
Who was the other main lead singer? There were two main lead singers and one guy who sang some.
When you get AIDS, your dick explodes?
Corey Wells sang a third verse on Family Man. And then we followed that up with this is Three Dog Night, It Ain't Easy. Great pictures, especially on the back cover. You got to show this. Well, we listened to Mama Told Me Not to Come, which I believe is written by Randy Newman.
That's right. And he sent him a message.
Look at the back cover. Show the back cover pictures, especially the top and the bottom. There's like they're wearing these weird masks on the bottom, but on the top, it like totally like in some kind of weird shit in the sun or something. I don't know what's going on.
Randy Newman sent him a message. It was like, thanks for sending my kids to college.
Yeah, he texted him. He said, thanks for sending my kids to college. 1972, probably.
So he didn't text him in 72.
No, not at all.
He sent him a teletype.
A fax.
No. Previous to that.
A teletype. Oh, no, he sent him a Western Union.
There you go.
Grand.
And a man on a horse showed up. Let's do one of these guys.
What's that?
Pop Off. Oh. The official sponsor of Grown Man Record Night. When your liver has had enough and you've not.
And you're ready to
pop off.
Pop off.
For my man, Three Dog Night, and I'll tell you why I'm doing this. It's because I've mentioned this if you're an old school viewer of the program.
Corey Wells!
You may remember me talking about this, but Three Dog Night is the only, first and only concert my mom ever went to. My dad was a huge Three Dog Night fan, and he talked her into going to a show. My mom's, she's a musician, but she doesn't like loud rock and roll shows.
And some will complain, oh, that was pop music. Well, it was, but it was good music.
They knew what they were doing.
Those mothers, that sold like 16
good
gold
man.
Records. I mean, it was...
Mazel tov, man.
I take my hat off to that.
We'll see you on the other side,
and
Three Dog Night.
I'm not going to say I'm a singer, but, you know, singers... I tend to gravitate towards bands that have good singers.
Singer.
And this is a band with three lead singers.
As a guitar player, I would want nothing to do with that band ever in my entire life. That sounds like a fucking nightmare to me. A band with three lead singers? Oh my God. Woo! My head is about to explode talking about it. All right, you busted this guy out.
What?
This needs very little introduction.
Oh, yeah. And the reason I played this, actually, yesterday was the anniversary of the release of this.
Really?
This mug right here. This is Led Zeppelin II, the Brown Bomber album.
Yeah, it is.
And it's not a Robert Ludwig version, but I'll tell you what, it's a very clean, very nice.
That's from our man John.
Version from our man John Tambroni.
You got that on the when we split the records up.
Let me have that.
I chose Freak Out, the Frank Zappa Mothers of Invention first, and you got next pick, and you chose this one.
Well, thank you. I appreciate you not picking it.
No, I mean, I wanted the Freak Out was
good for you.
Yeah,
but I think it was released '69 on just October 22nd, I guess.
I'm going to actually pull this one to the side. We're going to talk about this a little later.
That one blew my mind.
It was great. It was great, but we're going to talk about that a little later.
Okay.
This was a dig of the week from last week.
Yeah.
Art Tatum Trio I picked up at the flea market.
Did you play it last week?
Hell, I don't know.
Because I figured you did.
Somebody said.
I made a comment like, he doesn't know what he plays.
I don't know. It's possible. Love for Sale.
It's an Italian release, right? It's a Verve.
It's the Italian Verve.
VSP. I've got a couple VSPs.
Do you really?
Yeah.
I saw one. This was a $10 record. I know it's crass to talk about price. Oh, fuck off. It was $10 record, and they were like, no, anything over six is half price. So that's a $5 record.
We're still good?
I think.
Yeah, we are. We're getting close, though.
But that's just cool.
Turn that over.
You turn it over, Carl. Lita of my mind. Jay really wanted to hear a little Chuck Berry, and I pulled this one out.
Chuck Berry.
We should have played some Johnny B. Goode because Back to the Future.
Back to the Future.
Actually, I watched it a few nights ago.
Going back. I showed my girls. They loved it. I think 2 and 3 suck, but number 1 is the
2's
one.
Okay. 3's
well, you know, well, 2's the one actually that people are referring to when they say on the anniversary because it was on that date that they traveled actually to this time. But people are telling me, no, man, it was number 1. No, it's not number 1. Number 1, they traveled to like
well, maybe at the at the very end of number 1 where he's going forward.
It wasn't, though. I watched.
Oh, really?
Very intently. Yeah, it's in number 2 where they do it.
Yeah, that's
we've got to go back.
There's something wrong with your kids, Marty. It's a portable television studio.
You know, when I worked with Zemeckis,
you work with Zemeckis?
Yeah, I worked with Zemeckis on Forrest Gump.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
Tell us about your time.
All I'll say is he got really mad because they had cater us for lunch, and they put us on a bus to take us across this long area to go to the area where they catered us, and that just took fucking forever to put all these people on a bus.
Yeah, I could see that.
He was really pissed off about that. And in the end, by the way, you never saw it because the whole scene got left on the cutting room floor.
But it's in the what
version? If you have the DVDs, it's in the special features version.
What was the scene?
It's a scene in Selma, Alabama. I was an Alabama State Patrol officer.
That's right.
Yeah.
And you're on the steps of the...
You can see me because I'm so close to the German Shepherds are a real central part of the scene.
Sie haben einen großen Hund.
Right behind the German Shepherds, so you can see at least my arms and some of me as they cut away. So that was it. That's my Zemeckis.
I'm stalling. I'm trying to stall.
That's my Zemeckis story. What do you got?
What? I'm trying, but I got to hold up though. Jay, want to hear some Chuck Berry? So what we're saying? We could have played the Johnny B. Goode. This is a weirdo Pickwick. Cameraman got in a group of records, and I told him, I was like, dude, I'll buy this from you. I'll trade it. And he never really said anything. He just kind of left it in my stack, and it's just been up here. So I'll give him a record or something one of these days. But it's a lot of songs that I'm not familiar with. Previously released on Mercury Records, it says. So it's not one of the Chess releases for Chuck. It's one of the Mercury's.
So,
Sweet Little Rock and Roller, Check Me Out, Ramblin' Rose, Good Night, Time to Go, Carol, Old Baby Doll, Back to
What I like Mercury is the sticker on the front says 3 for $2.
Look at the front and back cover on this mug is just primo.
Is that supposed to be Chuck Berry on the back? Dude.
On the back? Yeah, I'm pretty sure it is Chuck Berry.
Okay. All right.
What's going on here?
I don't know. You got one more. One more to talk about.
Yeah, I do. Actually, I don't.
Oh, you don't?
Actually, I don't. We're gonna hold that off for just a couple of minutes.
Well, you want me to tell you real quick what I had for lunch?
For lunch?
Well, no, what I dug.
You're talking about digs of the week?
My digs.
Oh, no.
I can go through some quick digs.
We're gonna get Steve to talk about a few
digs. Did you
digs.
Have anything to dig?
I didn't have anything. Let me tell you a little story. This week while I've been off, I put away a lot of the records that we've played recently down here in the floor that was cluttering up everything. I put everything on my shelf, and I kind of got everything squared away. I am 100% officially out of space. I don't have anything. I've actually got one half crate of records down here I can't fit on my shelves. So I'm going to have to figure some shit out before I really substantially go buy any records at all.
Damn.
Yeah, I don't care for it, to be honest. I'm going to have to figure something out because it's... I don't want to just have to stack records in stupid, nefarious positions.
I think you need to expand into the other room.
I'm going to have to buy some...
There's room out there.
I'm going to have to buy some business.
Have you thrown up the graphic?
Yeah, well, I already did the graphic.
Dig of the week?
Yeah, go on.
Okay, there's this... I recently shot a commercial for a furniture store. I think I might have talked about this, but I didn't show any records because I had a lot of other records to talk about.
Yeah.
But there's a consignment furniture place that go to homes, and I asked the lady, I say, do you ever come across any vinyl records? And she's like, oh, that's funny you asked, blah, blah, blah. Long story short, I scored some records from her, her graces, and I appreciate it. But it was like 100 records, and most of them I just didn't want to have anything to
How
do
much
with.
Did you see of her?
But I was able to pull a number that I wanted to keep for one reason or another. And starting with this Polydor record, it's a Paganini called Das Land des Lächelns, it's the Land of Smiles, basically. It's on Polydor.
Weird.
Paganini was this, you know, virtuoso violinist.
Yeah. I bet that's real good.
I think when he died, they cut his body up and buried it all over different places so that he wouldn't come back to life because they thought he was possessed by the devil. Famous Love Songs?
I've faced that same situation.
By Dean Martin. Look at that picture. Look how greasy that picture is.
He's so drunk right
there. That's why I wanted to keep this.
He's so drunk.
Yeah, I got to show this. But check this out. Dean Martin, Famous Love Songs. He is hammered.
Yeah, of course he is.
And tanner than tan can get.
He's orange.
And on the front, on the back's a nice picture of a bunch of people's heads.
I love a nice head picture.
Good head. Good head. I do like some Dean Martin, though. One of the Brat Pack.
Of course. I've got some Dean Martin records that are just killer. I love them.
I kept these because...
I got some other ones that are in.
I think there's one of our friends, Chris... No. Who loves some Hawaiian music, am I right?
Yeah, Chris likes Hawaiian music.
There were a couple here by Webley Edwards called Hawaiian... I don't know anything about it.
I've not seen these.
Hawaii Calls. This one's called... I'm going to move up. God damn it. What happened to our assistant? Hawaii Calls at Twilight.
Twilight.
So we have this. They also have another one. Webley Edwards presents More Hawaii Calls Greatest Hits.
Okay.
So some more good Hawaiian music. But last but not least, probably my favorite in this genre is Don Ho's Greatest Hits on Reprise, actually.
Hell yeah.
And I got one for you. This is Bob McGrath.
Oh, I've got a Bob McGrath from Sesame Street.
Sings for all the boys and girls.
Oh, yeah. I like to sing for boys and girls.
Here you go.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
That's my second Bob McGrath. Look how long his crotch is. That's an 18-inch fly right there. Pretty sure. It takes 3 seconds.
Last but not least, I did get some Christmas records.
Yep.
I got some Christmas records. I'm going to save those until later because I got some good ones.
Yeah.
That I don't like to keep a lot of Christmas records around.
Yeah.
But I got some good ones, so I'm going to save them for another time. But I did get this one. Really jumps out at me. It just seemed like weird. It's Songs for Well-Behaved Children. And what it's this is
Do
a great.
I have that?
This
I
is actually a
that.
Great record. It reminded me of the book, the guy who wrote Shel Silverstein.
That record I've
it's
got.
It's in the same kind of style.
I got a Shel Silverstein record.
You know, he talks to children, but he's.
Shel Silverstein also wrote a lot of songs for Dr. Hook and the Medicine Show.
Yes, he did.
And Johnny
Cash. He wrote I Got Stoned in a Mist.
Boy Named Sue. He wrote that.
There's a certain song on here though that is going to become lexicon. It's going to become part of our. It's called "Mommy, Mommy, I Got to Get a Record," and I'm going to work on that to get it into the show somehow because it's
nice.
It's amazing. So then I went to Durham and hit Nice Price Books,
right?
Like I was telling you,
yeah.
And I got three records in a. Short period of time, I was able to pick up. The first one I want to talk about is Peter Gabriel's
Melty Face.
Melty Face, the melt. It's the third of the Peter Gabriel solo records of that genre. This is the one that really he broke out with, and this is also the one where he established that he didn't want any cymbals. Phil Collins and another drummer, I can't remember who it was, but played on this record and. He specifically said, I don't want any cymbal.
Really?
Yeah, so there are no cymbals. So all of a sudden, his music takes on a more African feel, and this is where it started right here.
I was thinking that same thing about The Police earlier when we were playing that. How African, I know Stuart Copeland was really into the African sound, and how that really...
The second one I got here is...
I don't know what I'm saying.
I think it's my second...
I don't know what I'm saying.
...record by Camel.
Oh, yeah, well,
this is
Camel.
A prog record, the Canterbury Scene.
What year is that one?
Ah, shit.
That's all right. I don't mean to put you on the spot now.
I forget. You know, I left my phone at home. You know that.
I do know that.
Unfortunately. You know that really poorly. But yeah, this is called Rain Dances. I think it's maybe 77 or 78.
Because, you know, Mirage is terrific. And
yeah,
another
oh,
one
God,
is
yes.
Terrific. And but I've listened to one.
Moon Madness.
Yeah, yeah. There was another one I listened to that I was like, yeah, I don't know.
Okay, last but not least, this one is one I didn't have a good signal where I was, so I wasn't able to, and they don't have a viewing station or listening station.
Oh, that sucks.
But this is a band called Mushroom.
Oh, yeah, this looks great.
The album's called Compared to What? And I just had to take a chance on it because it was really hot. I mean, that's hot right there. Plus, Compared to What's one of my favorite numbers, you know, in terms of,
trying to make it real compared to what.
But it's a San Francisco band called Mushroom, and they play a lot of jazz and avant-garde and just all kinds of different things, electronic plus, you know, standard jazz. So
that seems awesome.
But what I heard, I really liked when I finally got it home. So
it's got
to
be good.
That's man, I'm sweating.
Sweating.
It's wore me out. I'm
sweating.
Done. I'm spent.
All
I'm
right.
Spent.
Well, in the middle of this. I'm telling you, folks, if you don't know about how this program kills fascists, you should know by now.
You should know by now.
And I have to tell you, we got a special guest coming up here. If you hadn't known what the deal was yet, got a special guest.
Give me a cold envelope.
Coming in. Your last chance to take a guess. And here we go.
Hang on. I ain't ready.
It's Carl! Carl has graced us with his presence. Do you choose channel? Of course
no.
We're going to talk about Lamar Odom, Jay. Just give
oh,
me a fucking
fuck
minute
about
for
Lamar
crying
Odom.
Out loud. We got Carl the Envelope back on the scene.
Oh, yeah.
A couple weeks in from a few weeks. How was it?
A few weeks back, maybe a month and a half back.
Yeah, man.
Made the appearance, but...
That's very cool, man. Kind of just jumping back up.
Yeah, I had a random chance to get up in the area tonight.
Get up in your area like malaria.
The wife was coming up to visit a friend, so I was like, yeah, I'll ride up. Drop me off at Miller's.
Do a
grown man record night.
Do you hear how urban I just got?
Drop me off at Miller's.
I just got
drop me
urban
off at Miller's. Make me some waffles, moccasin face.
Well, that one ain't no good to me anymore. That's broke.
Yeah, that's broke.
Okay. Well, shit, Carl. Tell me what's going on. You've been doing a lot of record digging?
Little bit, man. Actually, one we played earlier, my best dig recently was at the public library book sale.
Oh, I love the book sales, man.
Love the book sale. They always got the little audio visual section. Actually, our library broke it out a little better this year. Made it its own little AV room.
Oh, that's cool.
Had a lot of CDs, a lot of DVDs. Decent little rack of vinyl. Whole lot of classical, you know, bunch of 78s, the stuff you'd normally expect at the library. But there was one album, came across buried in there. Pretty ratty condition, but it was interesting. Called the Escorts. We listened to that earlier.
Yeah, it was actually part of what we played.
We can get into a what we played and a dig of the week combo here.
The Escorts.
Three down, four to go. This was recorded in 1974 in Rahway State Penitentiary. Eastern New Jersey.
In the penitentiary they recorded this.
In the penitentiary.
Wow.
It's called Three Down, Four to Go because three members of the band had already been released from prison. Four were still waiting their release dates.
Wow. That's great. Let's hold this guy up.
Yeah,
let's get this up there. That's nothing I've ever seen. Probably most of you cats either.
I picked it up because of the cover.
Yeah, the cover caused you to turn it over.
The cover caused me to turn it over and read the back. And once I started reading the back, I bought it.
That's cool, man.
It sounded like the Skull Snaps a little bit.
Yeah, it was very funky.
Very funky. You can get the Black Power feel to it for sure. It was that time, 1974.
It wasn't a Suck Face with Your Lady Soul record, which you always run that. Which, those are good too, but, you know.
They have their place,
not
for
sure. Not for record night. But, yeah.
But, Alethea Records.
Alethea.
I never heard of them before.
Alethea.
I'm not sure how to pronounce it. But, yeah, Alethea Records, North Bergen, New Jersey, 1974.
Wow, that's cool, man. Never seen that one.
Nah, I hadn't either.
And before we came out on this job,
before we came on,
you played this guy.
We were jamming some Cor Blund.
You bought some Cor Blund last time, and I really like this guy. And I told you, I would have never played this guy because his name is so fucking stupid. I would have never played his records. And when I played him, or you played him last time, I'm like, wow, this guy's really good.
Yeah, I'm really impressed with Cor Blund. Brought a couple last time on the show. Talked about him some then. Western Canada.
Canadian redneck.
Yeah, he's a Canadian redneck.
It's good stuff, though.
Yeah, it's good country.
Canadian Hank the Three.
Somewhat. Quite as rowdy and rebel as Hank Three. More of the singer-songwriter, storyteller genre.
Sure.
A lot of the songs still tell stories. But I really dig it. Real good groove. A lot of his stuff has a kind of a bluesy feel to it almost.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
But Cor Blund just released a brand new album 3 weeks ago. I haven't got it yet. Looking to pick it up on vinyl. Probably going to order it straight from his website.
Oh, yeah.
But it's called Things That Can't Be Undone.
Cool.
And I've heard a couple songs off of it, and I'm impressed again. That would be his eighth studio album.
Wow.
But he's just starting to gain recognition in the United States. He's got a big following in Canada, a big following in Australia, New Zealand, for some reason.
Very cool.
Yeah, big into Cor Blund these days. One of my new favorite artists.
Hell yeah, man. Keep it moving.
All right, speaking of digs, me and the wife went digging recently. Couple old classics here we scrounged up. Can never go wrong with a good Billy Idol.
Oh, yeah, man.
Now, we didn't have this in our collection. This has White Wedding on it. Dancing with Myself, you know. Get that Billy Idol lip going.
Sweat.
Let's get that Billy Idol lip front and center.
Yeah, man.
Generation X.
Yeah. And yes, I did pay $7 for it, but. We're not talking about prices.
No, we're not. That's crass. You want to be crass, do you, Carl?
Oh, I'm you crass. Want, I'm you punk, ever, dude. I'm no, more punk than you.
I'm more punk than you.
Another dig recently I was really stoked on. Marty Robbins, Streets of Laredo. I've gotten into some of the old country recently. This has Big Iron on his hip on it, Cowboy in the Continental Suit. Just some of the good old Western classics from Marty Robbins.
They're playing the game. Somebody's already guessed one of your other records.
Red River Valley.
Right. David Allan Coe?
Nope. No, I don't want to say what it is.
That's my other country dig right there is David Allan Coe's greatest hits.
Oh, yeah. I'd love to have some David Allan Coe. I don't have any David Allan
Coe. That's a great greatest hits album. Actually, we should get that on shortly after.
You know, speaking of prison records, he has an album that he recorded in prison.
Yeah, have you heard it?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's dirty.
Yeah, doesn't he use the N-word?
Every third word.
Yeah, he likes the N-word.
I believe he has a song on that album called Don't Bite the Dick That Fucks You, Honey.
That's funny. That reminds me, I need to call my uncle tomorrow.
Wow.
Oh, my gosh.
Okay, so my last few new ones have actually been new releases.
Okay, cool. Hey, before you do that, let me jump in with this one.
Jump in.
I didn't buy any records this week, but I meant to play this earlier. And this is just so mind-blowing when I read this stat. Genesis Trespass.
Yeah.
Dude, today, released 45 years ago today.
Today?
45. That just seems stupid.
Like, that does seem stupid.
You mean like 25, right? No.
45.
As great of an album Genesis Trespass is, that's 45 freaking years ago. And I meant to play it during the stuff we were playing before the show so that we could just talk about it and what we played. But I forgot.
But you got to work it in.
I have a substance abuse problem. Where's your empathy, brother?
I feel you.
I forgot to play it. But we'll play it later maybe or something. It's a great record. 45 years
ago.
Crazy.
Yeah, so getting into old stuff, man, that I can't believe how old it is.
Carl.
So my other three digs are, well, two brand new releases and one that is a reissue, which I'm really stoked on.
Yeah, you are.
The first two Anthrax albums, Fistful of Metal and Armed and Dangerous.
Woo!
On triple 10-inch vinyl.
That's seminal for our generation, man.
That's two records on three records.
Plus some live tracks, plus some rare bonus tracks that have never been issued since 1983. Yeah, this is 1982,
1983. How many tracks
do
the original records have on them? Like eight?
They're probably 10 apiece, roughly.
I'm not on the mic, by the way.
What are you, Jay?
I think Fistful of Metal had 10 tracks on it. Armed and Dangerous had 6 or 8, maybe. And then we've got Metal Thrashing Mad and Panic Alive and Soldiers of Metal and Howling Furies, which have never been released since Anthrax put out their original 7-inch in 1982.
That's cool.
Hold on.
That's
before
like...
you show that,
okay,
we'll slip that one out.
Right. This just came out, like, what, last week or this week? I mean,
this
it's
has
like
been out
recent.
A few weeks. But look at the vinyl.
Oh, that's cool.
That's some good vinyl right there.
You gotta show the vinyl, Steve.
I don't have the vinyl.
No, right here, man.
It's right behind you.
Oh, shit.
Look at that guy.
Look at that.
Oh, my God.
I love how this fits in.
I just threw up all over my dick. We're gonna start the show over. My dick's got throw up on it. I'm not comfortable with continuing.
Called the
draw. That's cool. Like a die cut cover?
Mm hmm.
Yeah, it's a die cut.
And
that
slips in. Yeah.
Sweet.
Yeah, that's really cool, man. Love some
Anthrax.
Yeah,
I was really stoked on this.
Just...
And for being 1982 and 1983 recordings, the way they remastered the sound quality on this is really impressive.
A band like Anthrax is a band that reminds me of you. And like
I've
back
loved
in the day.
Anthrax,
yeah,
man.
Like I've always liked Anthrax. You've liked Anthrax and always remind me of Ben Wendland as well.
Yeah.
Some of my first friends that were like, yo, you got to check out, you like Metallica? I'm like, yeah, Metallica kicks ass. I'm like, yeah, check out Anthrax. And Ben was like, check out M.O.D. You ever heard of M.O.D.? And I'm like,
I love M.O.D.
Yeah, Billy Mulatto, I'm a book regis, man. He is.
Yes, he is.
A lot of people in the vinyl community get upset because apparently he's a racist or something.
Billy Mulatto?
Yeah, apparently Billy Mulatto has a lot of racist. I don't know.
It happens. His music is pretty good. M.O.D. was good. S.O.D. was better.
Yeah.
Thanks to Scotty.
He may have just trying to be funny and just failed. But, yeah, you know, I don't know.
See, I'm going to jump into my last two for this evening.
Do it, man.
Brand new releases, both of them.
Cool.
And I'm real impressed with both. Got Social Distortion's brand new release, L.A. Prison Bound.
Cool.
Say that if it makes you feel better.
Pass that on up there. And, yeah, I never even heard that one. A few weeks ago, a friend came over with that album, autographed by Mike Ness.
Wow, cool.
And we threw it on the table and listened to it, and I was pretty impressed. So I saw it in the record store last week, snatched it up.
Before you go to the last one?
Oh, yeah.
Metal Theologian says Anthrax was his second show ever. Tell me about your first show ever.
First real, well, it wasn't my first show because my parents took me to like the Beach Boys when I was like five.
Well, I wish my parents would have done that.
But my first real metal show ever was Clash of the Titans.
Now, explain what Clash of the Titans was.
What's that?
It was either 87 or 88. It was Slayer, Megadeth, Anthrax, with Alice in Chains opening. And my mom took me and two of my friends to that show in Fayetteville, North Carolina. And she bought a ticket too and came into the show. And it was general admission, so, you know, we set up.
Was she high?
No. My mom works at a church. My mom's straight edge.
Okay.
But ever since, not straight edge, she'll get her drink on, for sure.
Not that there's anything wrong with that.
No. But ever since 1987, my mom has been an Alice in Chains fan.
Wow, because of that show.
Because of that show.
Very cool.
And that was my first show. That was my first pit was Slayer in Fayetteville.
That's a violent pit.
And
I was like 13.
Leading to that, you know, that's one of my greatest musical achievements is opening for Slayer.
Yeah, I'm still impressed you opened for Slayer.
Thanksgiving night. Which seems even more impressive that it's Thanksgiving night because it's...
And I wasn't at that show.
It's when you give thanks and you eat blood because...
Slayer.
In Atlanta at the Tabernacle.
Yeah, speaking of Slayer.
Here we go.
Slayer's brand new album released a month ago.
World premiere.
Wow.
My personal opinion, and I've been a Slayer fan since the 80s.
Yeah.
My personal opinion, that is the best Slayer album since Seasons in the Abyss.
Whoa. That's saying a shit ton right there.
I'm not saying it's better than South of Heaven or Rain and Blood.
Right.
But I'm saying it's the best one since Seasons in the Abyss.
That's hardcore, man.
Their new lineup is killing it. Paul Bostoff on drums.
Yeah.
Took Dave Lombardo's place after he quit again. But Paul Bostoff, you know, has a solid metal tradition. Testament, Exodus.
Oh, Testament. Some of the best metal riffs ever.
He was in Exodus before that.
Me and Bo used to play Testament riffs.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, totally.
And then, of course, Gary Holt from Exodus took Jeff Hanneman, rest in peace, took his place on rhythm guitar.
Wow, that's cool. Let's do us a little Slayer shot. Grab you some of it. I poured you a little thing.
Here's the Jeff Hanneman, Slayer and the Boys.
The Slayer. Live forever. Oh, hail Satan.
Raise hell shit in the bed.
I mean, really. All right, folks, what we're going to do, we're going to take a quick commercial break. And we're going to come back with a little sober speak and chip chat. And I wanted
some sauce.
Spreckens' sauce? With a so to speak tie-in. Yeah, so be sure to check out our Facebook page, and if you're not down with our YouTube page yet, I mean, I'll fight you, but I'm going to give you a chance to go like it before I fight you. But if you don't like it after I've told you, I'm going to fight you.
Or I might come over.
I'm going to fight you. And then when your mom gets mad that I beat your ass, I'm going to fight her too. That's how I roll. That's just the way we do it here. So we'll be right back here on Grown Man Record Night. Enjoy these commercials. On this It's Carl special.
Panasonic introduces our smallest, lightest VHS video recorder. When linked to this Panasonic video camera, this system responds as quickly as the action unfolds, focusing automatically, adjusting to changing light instantly. It even works in low light. And with a special Panasonic tape, it records 8 hours of TV. 8 hours. Panasonic Omnivision. No other portable VHS system does more.
It's amazing what Panasonic did to Regivision.
Omnivision. antenna. Now you can draw the roundest circles, perfect straight lines in any direction, even complicated geometric patterns, perfect every time with the amazing rolling ruler. The secret tool of architects and draftsmen has two tire-like gripping rollers that keep the rolling ruler level as it speeds across your work. The special meter automatically indicates the distance between your lines. Rolling ruler makes professional-looking office forms, charts, graphs, school projects come alive. Do geometry and trig faster and easier. Craftspeople find it irresistible. Dress patterns can be altered to any size. The handyman will love the built-in protractor for perfect angles or make beautiful curves and long straight lines that go on and on. Call or send for rolling ruler right now. Simply insert your pencil into any hole and roll straight lines, parallel lines. Insert two pencils and roll curves, arcs, and circles instantly. Redecorate like a professional. Replan your lawn and garden to perfect scale. Get results you'll be proud of. Kids love it just for doodling. Call or send $12.98 to Rolling Ruler now. You'll also receive the amazing pantograph. Copy your favorite photos, cartoons, or designs to any size in just minutes. Finish with the confidence of a real artist. You'll impress yourself. Call or send now. You get the rolling ruler and the amazing pantograph for only $12.98. Order now.
So are you guys getting hungry?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Do you ever worry that they're playing too much Nintendo?
Oh, not anymore. See, Matt has Bible adventures. They're actually learning Bible stories while they're playing Nintendo.
Quick, get that Bible quote before you run out of power.
Bible Adventures features three games in one cartridge. Noah's Ark, Save Baby Moses, and David and Goliath. A must for every family with Nintendo. Call 1-800-77-BIBLE. That's 1-800-77-BIBLE.
Hey everybody, we're back. Thanks for sticking with us here on Grown Man Record Night. This is where you want to be on a Friday night. It's a place to cleanse your soul of all the week's trespasses. Like the Genesis record. I'm crossing over with that guy. If I remembered that psychic's name and I said crossing over, what's his name?
John Edwards.
Crossing over. See,
$400 haircut.
I would have ruined the joke though.
Some of your money.
Don't eat it yet.
John Edwards.
Okay. All right, so we're going right into a so to speak.
Oh my God.
We got a so to speak going on here now. Now I don't know what the hell's going on.
What did they bring us? What did they bring us?
All I know about this is Boss Man brought it.
Boss Man brought this one.
This is from World Market.
World War II.
I believe it's an Austrian herbal soda.
Okay. You read any of that on there?
Snotricon.
Okay.
I
know a little German because I had to sing Brahms.
I have an intermediate proficiency of the German language, so this is my resume.
Almdudler.
Almond.
Natural alpine herb soft drink.
Alpine?
Aus natürlichen alpinen Krauten. Yes, alpine, which means basically Bavaria or Austria. Southern Germany and Austria, basically.
Very cool.
So
can.
It's soda water. This will taste
like
flavor.
This will taste like the Black Forest.
Oh, nice.
Yes.
It'll taste like the Wizards and Warriors map. I found a print King of the Wizards Richard, and Warriors King map.
Vihard,
nice. Beat that on any
and Vihard Wagner music. Awesome. You should listen to Wagner while you drink this, by the way.
Okay.
But sir, that's Charlie's point.
Charlie, don't surf. It smells like victory.
Love the smell of napalm in the morning.
What do you got? Is it like a Ricola? A liquid version of Ricola? That's what I'm imagining. I haven't tasted this yet.
I don't know what that is.
He didn't Carl it. Hey, what about the Carl?
Oh, the Carl?
Speaking of Carling it.
What the hell is that?
A great museum.
It's kind of devoid of flavor.
I went to
flavor.
A museum with
it's
my
devoid
family.
Devoid of flavor, but it
we
has
shared,
tang.
We shared a drink.
Right.
And the Carl method was in play.
Oh.
Do we have a clip?
We do. Stand by.
Okay.
All Okay, so tell me about the tell me what we got going on here.
We were sharing a drink, and I said, you know, we could do the Carl method. They were well aware of Carl the Envelope.
Your daughter just jumped right on it. They knew what to do.
We all sing the song.
They knew what to do.
To the annoyance of my wife. But Carl the Envelope is a popular song. And I taught them the Carl method. So this is the Carl method on a soda. Is that a Sprite? What is that? I don't know.
It looks like a Country Time lemonade.
Okay, it was a
lemonade. Or Minute Maid.
A Minute Maid lemonade.
Minute Maid.
The Carl method. And I don't think she pulled
a little bit of whiskey in it.
Half of it ended up on her shirt.
That's all right.
Yeah.
She's not doing it right.
Shirts, you can get shirts anywhere. What is this, Russia? You can get shirts all over the place.
Oh my God, this is terrible.
You think
it's kind of what I thought.
Well,
it's not, you know, it's not terrible. It's
you
not
think
anything.
It's going somewhere and it doesn't
but
go anywhere.
But it doesn't go anywhere.
It's like a carbonated soda.
But I do.
It doesn't really go anywhere.
I do appreciate
it. It has
those,
no flavor.
You show, get a good picture of that that fun graphic.
Yeah, the can and the graphic is kind of fun, but
yeah,
the flavor just ain't
the,
happening,
couple,
man.
With the couple there enjoying their time together. And but the it's weird. There's an herbal thing going on there, but...
It's subtle,
yet
provocative.
It's subtle yet crappy.
I like it because it's low on sugar. It doesn't taste like you're just pouring corn syrup.
Yeah,
it
tastes
mouth.
Like carbonated water with something going on.
A little something going on, which I think but a lot of the Europeans may have that figured out. Cause
but it's not enough of a something going on.
True, but Americans have to be like, you got to
pour is.
Corn syrup. Now,
no, it's not the corn
but
syrup.
There's no prevailing sharp herb that jumps out and smacks you like a
there
like
should
a,
be a
like
flavor.
A ginger
or a cinnamon or
like
anything.
It's probably like an echinacea or something that comes in and grabs
I like it. I like that.
There you go.
I enjoy
mixed,
that.
I mean, it could be refreshing on a hot day.
Mixed emotions.
Good
and a
thirsty.
Good mixer. Speaking of mixed.
Speaking of mixed.
Could be a good mixer.
Vodka. I think you got something.
Vodka in this guy?
Anything with vodka.
And a little twist?
A twist of whatever.
Okay.
It's got potential.
Tonight, we have a little crossover going from our, so to speak, into our Chip Chat.
Yes.
Which is very unique for us. And we've been wanting to do this this segment.
We've done it from time to time.
Here and there.
We talk about serving suggestions.
We do.
We don't have anything called serving suggestions as a graphic. Hint, hint.
What's thin?
Well, it's what we have here is basically a North Carolina dip. That has a little more molasses and a little of the soda we speak of added to it.
All right.
This is called Kakalaki Cheerwine.
Let's hold that up before we even try. I want to kind of preface it before we even go down
okay,
this road.
Okay, we're calling it.
Yeah.
This is Kakalaki Cheerwine Sweet Sauce.
And yeah,
it's from a company called Kakalaki. It's a and Kakalaki is like a street name for Carolina.
You North can, Carolina.
No, you could say you're from South Kakalaki or North Kakalaki.
North Kak or South Kak.
So,
yeah. But the North Kak is the real Kak.
It's like the Eastern style of North Carolina dip.
Okay.
But they've added a little more molasses and the Cheerwine flavor.
Okay, so let's grab. We got
so
some cold
I've got
pizza
here.
Here
is some cold pizza from your man. Where's this from?
Bill's Pizza Pub.
Bill's Pizza.
Greensboro, North Carolina. Carl?
My favorite.
Whenever Carl comes to town, he goes by Bill's Pizza in Greensboro.
And so we're going to dip this in the Kakalaki. I'll tell you what.
Wow.
This is good.
Mm-hmm.
That's real good.
I will recommend, though, that you try the Kakalaki spice sauce.
It could use some more spice.
Their main ingredient, by the way, in sauce, their main ingredient is sweet potatoes.
Hmm.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Yeah.
They're
from Pittsburgh, by the way.
Mm.
I've been through Savannah, Charleston, back through Greensboro, Burlington.
I learned about this, by the way, I've got my Kakalaki hat on here. I learned about this by... We're working on a commercial for a local Biscuitville, and they've inked a deal, and the Kakalaki sauce
you play a Biscuitville commercial.
Is on one of their sandwiches.
Nice.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a good sweet sauce. Right there. I could see slathering that up on some ribs.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord.
And a rack of baby backs or some chicken wings after you put a hot, dry rub on it.
Anything you're going to barbecue.
There you go.
You put a hot, dry rub on, then you put a sweet liquid
That's
sauce on.
That's the ticket.
On. I always cook
it needs
my
a little more spice, though.
That's not.
I recommend the spice sauce. Oh, the dry rub?
You don't need to.
Make your dry rub spicy.
Okay.
You put a hot dry rub on.
I'm
get a sear on. Then sauce it with
I
the sweet.
My pants.
If I go to a graphic and come back, I expect Carl's shirt to be off.
Covered in barbecue sauce.
I'm an American. That's what I expect. That's good stuff. I already threw up the Chip Chat graphic because somehow I thought that was a transition.
Well, we went from... That was kind of a...
sort of.
That was an interlude. That was an interlude.
Sprekenzie
sauce. We got a friend, Bad Benny.
He wants to do a sauce segment.
He wants
us
to do a segment called Sprekenzie sauce. And this would fall into that category. But
it would.
Sprekenzie sauce.
I've suggested to him they do his own Sprekenzie sauce.
Well, because this was a cheer one,
it kind of fits into so to speak.
It fits into so to speak.
Because it is cheer one.
Cheer one is the case born in the Carolinas, raised
in the
glass.
Of course
it is. We got the thermometer right back there. All right, let's go into a little chip chat. Got a couple things I want to talk about here now. Larry the Cable Guy. We've done a couple of the Larry the Cable Guy chips before.
Oh.
Yeah, you want to over there?
Clear the studio.
Holler Pino Popper. That's my favorite food in the entire world is a jalapeno popper. These are the...
I like them. I like a jalapeno popper a lot.
The cream cheese jalapeno
popper. So what type
of
chip is this? Is this a potato chip?
Potato chip.
Okay, it's a popper potato chip.
Yep. Plain, like Lay's style chip. No
just a
ripples.
Seasoned chip.
No ripples. No...
Jalapeno popper from... Tomater. A guy from Nebraska, he acts like he's from Georgia.
A lot more heat, and yet a lot more subtle than I thought it was going to be. This one probably...
Oh, damn.
Probably more than any chip in recent memory.
Like a sour cream and onion.
Doesn't meet what I thought it was going to be.
Nah, that was surprising.
Where's the jalapeno? Okay, just...
wait for it.
It's pretty hot.
That shit's hot.
It's like a sour cream and onion that over a while starts to grow on you and then bang.
Sour cream and onion with heat.
It's pretty good, and I didn't think it was going to be good at all.
It's not a jalapeno popper.
No.
It's just hot.
No, it's got its own little thing going on. Nowadays, I really appreciate chips that have their own thing going on.
Yeah? Yeah. I can dig that.
You know, and that's definitely something that it doesn't taste like any other chip we've ever done.
No, it doesn't. I was talking to Mike earlier about another chip that doesn't taste like any other chip that I just discovered the other day. Old Bay potato chip.
Oh, yeah, we did those on the program.
We did Old Bay. It's like a crab chip.
It's like a crab chip.
Kind of, but better.
You like them better than the crab chip?
Yeah. I like the Old Bay, the Her brand.
Yeah.
Her, whatever. H-E-R-R is Her.
Cameraman, because of
Car
Avenue.
Right, in Wilmington. I still call it Car Avenue. Screw them.
Refused to say Her. He's called it Hars.
Well, there's also a car drug.
Yeah.
Anybody doesn't know, North Carolina is the state of like 7 million people and 12 last names. And Har or Her is one of those.
I've had sex with all of them.
Yeah.
My dick looks like a road map with AIDS.
Okay.
What did I just say? Hey, a few years
ago. You said moving on.
A few. Those get hot after a
while. Yeah, don't light you up.
You ever seen the Royal Tenenbaums? You look just like the guy, the tennis player from the Royal Tenenbaums.
Oh, yeah?
He loses his shit. He's got like the glasses and the headband and the suit jacket.
Is that the O.R. They movie?
It's one of the Wilsons, but not Owen, the other one.
When he says, are you...
I'm not the crappy one.
I'm wearing O.R. scrubs. Oh, are they? Isn't it the Royal Tenenbaums?
I don't know. Sorry.
Okay.
Halfway through your chip chat.
Several years ago.
Several?
Our good buddy, speaking of which, we've been playing the Sean 0612 tracks, the hip-hop instrumentality records. He sent me a tweet, and it's like, man, have you guys ever seen these? Funyuns. Steakhouse onion Funyuns.
No, we haven't.
I'm like, no.
Let's have a picture of which steakhouse.
somebody's blooming onion.
But let me tell you what, man, for real, that was like, what was that, 2011?
It was a long time ago.
2011? and that's New Jersey. We're just getting them here.
Wow.
Right now.
Steve, and it's probably just a limited thing. I don't
where'd
know
you pull these out?
I don't know. It was in a convenience store. And we'll probably never see him again.
I remember him sending me that picture and be like, holy shit, steakhouse, like steak sauce Funyuns? Are you kidding me?
What? I love a good Funyun.
Give it up.
I'll make a baby in this bag.
Fuji's and Funyuns.
Mmm.
Is it good?
Oh, my
like
God.
Like a steak with onions?
Hold up, guys.
Oh, yeah.
A1
flavor?
No.
Yeah, basically.
That's some bomb ass.
It's like an A1 Funyun.
A1-yun.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God. That's an A1-yun for sure.
A1-yun. It's just what I've been waiting on my whole life.
Mmm.
Good.
That and being able to marry my brother, who's so fucking hot. My brother is so hot. When we were like kids and we'd go to the pool and he would take
like
his shirt off.
Child.
Wow, that's a good man.
Wow.
That is a goddamn good funny good. Bomb.
That, okay. But, that's a chip of the year nominee. We're up to maybe 3 or 4
for
the year.
All you gotta do is take something plain like a Funyun.
That's awesome.
And add something sweet to it like that and you get something special.
And Funyuns are awesome to begin with.
Phenomenal.
But
that takes
it to the next level right there.
The Funyuns and the Munchos are two chips that Frito-Lay just could not get rid of. They probably wanted to, but there was this there was this niche market they just couldn't touch, you know.
Oh,
that's incredible.
That's really good.
That's really up there for chip of the year.
That is.
I don't want to.
That might have my vote.
I don't want to speak out of school, and there's still a few more months left.
Right.
That's up there. Definitely an nominee.
That's big news. In case
maybe Southern Biscuits and Gravy.
Speaking of big news, here we go for some other big news. Stand by. Here we go. We got the winner of the Lay's Do Us a Flavor Challenge is the Southern Biscuits and
Drum
Gravy.
Roll.
Oh, yeah.
Which was...
Biscuits and Gravy.
Haley,
whatever.
Something. Yeah.
Somebody.
She got her money.
Some girl with some titty balls on this picture here now. She won her $1 million. So them titty balls just grew about 4 sizes.
Yeah.
Well, all that money. good for her, though, man. The Biscuits and Gravy is the ones that
we
won.
We liked it.
Oh, yeah. We liked it.
That was
featured it on the show. Yes. Last time I was here, I brought up all
that's
4
right.
flavors.
Carl brought
all 4 flavors.
That's why you're here. That's why you're back.
So
now it's
the
winner.
Yeah.
Fuck it. I think it's Haley Green.
Coincidentals and
it's
shit.
It's coincidental.
Haley Green, maybe. Yeah. I want to say Haley Green.
Well, congratulations, Haley. You did a good job.
Yeah, that's good. Good for you,
Haley.
You
know, Haley.
Coming back,
whatever
I said name
done, I do like the truffle ones that they have.
The truffle fries were good.
That's a close second, in my opinion.
I didn't mind
they
any
were good.
Of these. None of these were just like, what the fuck are you doing?
That last round was bonkers bad.
The last
the Reuben or the
it tastes like a fruit salad. It was like
no, you're talking about like last year stuff. Mm. A lot of those were bad.
Chicken waffles
was
pretty
good, but it now
it was just straight syrup.
It's too
it just
syrupy.
Tasted like syrup.
This year you had the biscuits and gravy, terrific. Reuben, terrific.
Truffle fries, good.
Terrific. Hero.
The New York
hero.
Hero.
Oh, I can't get behind that.
Nah,
okay.
I couldn't get
it was
behind
like
that.
Too much dill or something.
It was overloaded with dill.
And last year they had the cappuccino chips and those fruit salad bullshit chips.
That was like a vision thing.
This year we really raised it, the bar.
Yeah.
I take bars, I raise them. I throw them out of my window.
Man, I've been thrown into burger bars in this.
Yeah.
Burger bars.
Burger bars.
Oh, that sounds like a great idea.
Let me get a Diablo sandwich, a Dr. Pepper, make it snap him in a goddamn hurry. Thanks for joining us, Grown-Man Recognite. Thanks, Carl, for joining us.
All right.
Answer the question.
Grown-Man Recognite.
What was what?
There were 4 lawyers. One of them was German.
That's from Stroker Ace.
Thank you.
Thank you. Which my wife referenced in a text right before we went on the air. She said, I got to hear Stroker Ace on the way to Winston.
Oh, my God. That's funny. But no, in Stroker Ace, Jim Neighbors says, I talked to 4 lawyers. One of them is even a German, and all of them said the same thing.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. So if anybody said Stroker Ace,
you
I don't know.
You get the prize.
You get the prize of me saying.
Of bragging rights.
Your mama. I don't know. That's a prize.
You get the bragging rights prize.
You get to send me pictures of your mama's vagina.
You go.
You win. And I probably lose because even the picture probably smells like a roast beef sandwich. Thanks for joining us for Grown Man Record Night. Be sure to catch us next week, which will be our pre-Halloween special.
Woogie boogie.
We're going to woogie boogie. I'm going to take my assault rifle out, and we'll shoot each other in between
seconds. We'll play nothing but Slayer all night.
Slayer. We love that. It'll be a good time. So, I don't know, folks. For Jay and Steve Fever and Carl the Envelope, I'm Mikey Bananas. We'll catch you next week. We appreciate and love each and every last one of you. Y'all look out for one another, and we'll see you next time here on Grown Man Record Night.